Hi there, everybody, and a very pleasant good evening to you wherever you may be. It's time for Dodger Baseball Chronicles. My name is Peter Trunk. My co-hosts are Ronnie Rabinowitz and Robert Cole, as always. And we're here tonight. We're going to do a show on Maury Wills. Okay, this is the Maury Wills show. I will start us off. We're just going to, you know, Maury Wills was, not many people know that Maury Wills was signed by the Brooklyn Dodgers. And not only was he signed by the Brooklyn Dodgers, but he was signed in 1950. He stayed in the minor leagues for many, many years. And he only was called up in June of 1959. But he was the Dodger shortstop from 59 to 66. The Dodgers traded him. And then he came back to the Dodgers, right. Wills did, after leaving them. I think he went to Pittsburgh and then he went to Montreal. He came back to the Dodgers and spent 1969 through 1972 with the Dodgers. Anyway, he his greatest year was 1962. He won, Maury Wills won the Most Valuable Player Award. He had 104 stolen bases. He was only caught stealing 14 times. Now, let that sink in a little bit. 104 stolen bases, only caught 14 times. He was a five-time All-Star. He played in seven All-Star games. There were two years that the All-Star game was played twice in the same year. He was the All-Star game most valuable player in 1962. So not only was he the most valuable player of the league, he was most valuable player of the All-Star game in 1962. That year, Maury Wills' lifetime hit 20 home runs. I saw Maury Wills hit two home runs in the same game at the Polo Grounds against the New York Mets. He hit one right-handed and he hit one left-handed. That's quite a feat for a guy when he had 20 of them lifetime. He was a high school quarterback. He played quarterback on offense and safety on defense. His teams in high school, this is hard to believe too nowadays, but his teams in high school were not only undefeated, they were unscored upon. Okay? Unscored upon. He later, of course, played some baseball. He got signed by the Dodgers. His father told the Dodger scout, "We want $6,000 to sign with you." The Dodger scout said, "How about $500?" Okay. And they signed him. So you signed for $500.
And a new suit of clothes.
And a new suit of clothes. I forgot to mention that.
And a new suit of clothes.
Yes. I'm not sure. I'm not sure if they were from you know who. Could sign win suit.
Yeah.
I don't know if they were from Abe Stark or not, but yes, he had a new suit of clothes and $500. he was on first base one time. I was watching a Met game, Mets and Dodgers, and Wills was on first base. And I don't know, Robert, you probably saw this game also because you watched a lot of Mets games and probably all of them against the Dodgers in 62 and 63.
Yes.
Roger Craig threw over to first base to keep him close 12 straight times.
Yes.
You know when a pitcher throws over three in a row, yeah. Everybody starts booing?
Yeah.
Or they even start booing, like, after the first one. But and after three of them, they're really booing. Even the home team is booing. Roger Craig threw over there 12 times. On the 13th pitch, he actually pitched, Will stole second base.
That was Roger Craig's way. any base stealer that got on, Roger Craig threw over a minimum of three or four straight times.
Yeah.
You know, that's just the way he was. But one other thing. 62 and 62, Peter, you know, when he stole all those bases.
Yeah.
But what people have to realize is opposing groundskeepers started watering down the dirt around first base. Okay, so he couldn't get a good start.
Right.
They started watering down around home plate, so he couldn't get a fast start out of home plate.
Right.
So there were a lot of things going against him.
Yeah.
And still, he went ahead and he did what he did.
Not only did they water it down, that's what they did in the beginning, but after a while, because Wills and the Dodgers would complain and the umpires would see that it was watered down and they would call time out and bring out extra dirt and clay and all that stuff. After a while, instead of watering it down, they actually changed the composite. They changed the entire composite of the ground. Leading off of first base with some sort of clay and sand and what have you underneath the dirt that would make it impossible to get a fast start. And yet Wills stole 104 bases and was only caught 14 times. Before I hand this over to Ronnie Rabinowitz, my partner, our partner, I just want to say one thing about Maury Wills being mentioned for the Hall of Fame. I'm only going to say this. I'm not going to make an argument out of it. I'm just going to state it. I'm just going to say it. The listener and the viewer will make up his or her own mind about it. I'm not going to try to change anybody's mind. I'm just going to state it. Here it is. Phil Rizzuto had 1,588 hits and batted 273 lifetime, won one Most Valuable Player award. Wills had 2,134 hits, okay, over 500 more hits, and he batted 281 instead of 273. Reese hit 269. Remember, Wills hit 281. Reese had 2,170 hits, playing many more games than Wills. He only had 56 more hits than Wills had. Wills had and continues to have, present tense, Hall of Fame numbers for a shortstop. I'm going to leave it at that, and I'm going to hand it off to my partner here, Ronnie Rabinowitz. Ronnie, tell us what you wish about Maury Wills. Before you start, did you ever meet him? Because you met a lot of Dodgers.
I did. I met him. Yes,
I did. Did meet him?
Yeah. And he was kind of one of my heroes when he was stealing bases like that.
Yeah.
And I used to, in high school, I was a junior, senior in high school, and I remember that the floors were very shiny. And these kids would always holler at me, "Do a Maury Wills, do a Maury Wills." And I'd run down the hall and slide, and they'd holler, "Safe." Well, I did this too many times. And some of the times were right in front of the principal's office.
Oh, no.
And I was called into the principal's office. And they wanted to know what the hell I was doing. And I said, "Well, I'm just imitating Maury Wills."
I hope he was a baseball fan.
Yeah, he laughed. He laughed. Oh, okay. He said, "Well, knock it off."
Okay.
But I still did it.
That's funny.
I was a stinker that way.
That's funny.
But no, he was great. I remember the year he stole 104 bases, and his legs. He was saying that how sore his legs were. You know, the skin was actually raw from all those slides, but he was phenomenal. He really was terrific. He knew to study pitchers, he knew their moves. It wasn't just take off and run. I mean, he worked on it. He was a great ball player, and he was a terrific teacher to other ball players. After he retired, he was a coach, and he used to teach many ball players how to steal bases.
He wasn't a very good manager, though, was he?
No, he wasn't a good manager, but he was an excellent teacher, excellent coach. And unfortunately, today nobody steals bases, or very few, you know. It's too bad. It's a lost art. And it really is an art. I mean, to be able to steal that many bases and beating Ty Cobb's record, which many people thought would never be broken, of 96 stolen bases, and here he did 104. It was incredible. It was exciting. And he got on base a lot. I mean, walking and getting hits. I mean, he was, had to be on base to steal a base, but he was terrific. Great guy. Very friendly.
A lot of hits. He did have a lot of hits.
Huh?
He did have a lot of hits.
A lot of hits. Absolutely.
A lot of hits.
Yeah. He was on base a lot. And he was a great guy. He was fun to talk to. And I met him several times in Milwaukee. And he was fun. Yeah. It was really fun.
He wasn't the fastest guy on the field, you know.
No, he wasn't the fastest guy in the field.
He wasn't the fastest guy in the field. And like you said, he studied those pitches. He had a book.
He had the art, though.
On those pictures. And he knew, he knew when not to go.
Right.
And when to go.
Right.
And like my little anecdote with the Mets pitcher, Roger Craig.
Ex-Dodger
pitcher. Craig threw over the first base 12 straight times. And on the next pitch,
he
stole second. Yeah. So he knew exactly when Craig was coming over to first, and he knew exactly when he wasn't coming over to first.
Right. He studied these. He really did. He was really great. And so I admired him, and I always looked up to him. And of course Jackie was a good stealer in those days too.
Yeah.
But he wasn't 104 bases.
Yeah. That's a lot. That's way more than Jackie Aaron.
It's a hell of a lot of bases.
Yeah.
It's a hell of. And as I say, his skin was real raw. I mean, he.
Yeah. He, in fact, when that season was over, he told the writers, "Don't look for me to do that again.
Yeah.
I'm not going to put my body through that.
Right.
Again. Right. And he never. And he didn't. And he didn't.
Yeah.
Robert, what can you tell us about Maury Wills?
Well, as far as the base.
By the way, Robert,
goes,
I like your hat.
Of course.
I have to commend you on the hat. Very, very nice. It's even got the white button on the top. I love it. Yes, yes, yes. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, as far as the base stealing goes, Wills gave a lot of credit to Pete Reiser for working with him in spring training. Pete Reiser was also an excellent base runner and base stealer.
Sure.
Okay, during his years when he was healthy. You mentioned Maury Wills playing high school football. Not only was he the quarterback and the starting safety, he was also the kicker for the team. Okay, so that gives you a little bit of, you know, an idea of the athleticism of him. You know, the Dodgers tried to give him away twice. Okay, they sent him to the Cincinnati Reds one winter. The Reds sent him back. And then before the 59 season, spring training, they sent him to Detroit. Okay, in Detroit, they gave him his first chance, and he always said that he was very grateful for that chance in Detroit because he got his first taste of major league spring training. Okay, ironically, the player who beat him out for the Detroit shortstop position was Rocky Bridges, and Rocky Bridges was also a Brooklyn Dodger, and Rocky Bridges and Maury Wills, you know, all through the minor leagues, played to see who was going to be the shortstop on certain teams. Okay, so that's an irony there. Okay, we go to the great year of 1962, and Maury Wills met and started dating, okay, lost my train of thought here, Doris Day, okay? All right. He started dating Doris Day. Okay, when the sports writers started asking him about that, okay, Buzzy Bavezzi called him into the office, said Walter O'Malley wants you to stop. Okay, you're a black man, she's a white woman. Okay, at this day and age, we can't have that. Although Wills was upset, Wills went ahead with it, stopped dating her. Later on, one of Maury Wills' books, he basically said he had been having an affair with Doris Day And when asked, said yes, he had a sexual relationship with Doris Day. Doris Day always denied that, said we were very good friends, but we never had a sexual relationship.
O'Malley got to Doris Day. O'Malley and or Bavese got to Doris Day and told her to back them up. They didn't want any part of that type of situation there.
Okay. And one of the things Maury Wills loved to do was play the banjo. They played the banjo in the dressing room. He played it on the trips, road trips. He started playing a lot in clubs in L.A. Always loved to play the banjo. In 1968, after the 1966 season, the Dodgers went on a trip to Japan. Maury Wills and several veteran players did not want to go. Walter O'Malley, of course, told Wills he had to go. Wills played a couple of games, said that his legs were bothering him, and basically went AWOL, just left on his own, and headed back to L.A. However, on the way back to L.A., he stopped in Hawaii and started playing in clubs with Don Ho and Sammy Davis Jr., which, of course, got back to Walter O'Malley, who was furious, and he immediately called Bavese in and said, get rid of him. Huh. Okay, which Bavese, of course, did, traded him to the Pittsburgh Pirates for Bob Bailey and Gene the Stick Michael. Played 2 years, okay with Pittsburgh, never really all that great. Okay, when the Montreal Expos came into being, he was left unprotected. Montreal Expos picked him up. He was hitting something like .222 for the Expos. Decided to retire. Okay, sat out for a few days, then went back to Montreal and said, I realize you have a big investment in me, so I'll come back. Montreal in turn turned around and traded him back to the Dodgers. And he went back to the Dodgers for a couple of years. Never did a whole lot. Bill Russell was coming up in 1968.
You know what was weird, Robert? When he returned to the Dodgers, okay, when he walked into the clubhouse, the game had already started. He was the only one in the clubhouse, the only player in the clubhouse. There was a note in his locker.
Right, from Walter O'Malley.
Walter O'Malley, welcome home, Maury.
Yeah.
After he got rid of him.
Yeah. Well, that was O'Malley, okay?
Yeah.
O'Malley did that with Leo DeRocha. O'Malley did that with a lot of people, you know.
Yeah.
If you could help him at the time, you know, you're his buddy.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you know, you're an enemy.
Yeah.
Sounds like somebody else will.
Sounds like somebody else right now. We know, right?
Right. Okay. And then, you know.
You froze up, Robert.
Yeah, you froze up.
Your TV screen froze up.
Went into some, did some coaching. Okay, wanted the minor leagues to manage. Buzzy Bavese wanted him to go to the minor leagues, okay, and, you know, get some experience. Wills refused to do that. Okay, Seattle signed him as a manager, okay. He was horrible, okay. He didn't even last into his second season. And part of the reason was he had a terrible cocaine habit. Okay, horrible. He estimated he spent over $1 million on cocaine during that period. And besides cocaine, he was also drinking heavily. He was out of control. Even got arrested one time for suspicion of stealing a car. And I believe that was he went on a test drive, for supposedly a test drive from a car dealership, never returned the car. They reported it stolen. And he also was in possession of cocaine at the time. Said himself that he didn't care whether he lived or died at that moment, during that period of time. Don Newcomb, Tommy Davis, and Fred Clare of the Dodgers pursued Wills all over Los Angeles.
I read that in Fred Clare's book,
over Los Angeles.
They followed him everywhere. And when he locked himself in his house, they camped outside.
Right.
Yeah.
Hounding him. And Maury Wills said in a couple of different books, if it hadn't been for the three of them, he'd be dead right now.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Right.
And, you know, Don Newcombe was given a lot of credit. Newcombe, you know, himself went through his demons with alcohol. Right. And straightened himself out. And he spent the rest of his life basically helping counseling others. And helping others.
Helping others.
Especially right. ball players.
Yeah.
And, you know, and there you go. I mean, Maury Wills, as Peter pointed out, probably has the numbers to go into the Hall of Fame. Whether that ever will happen, we'll have to wait and see.
It's too bad he's not in there.
I don't think he'll ever make it. Not in my lifetime, anyway. I don't think he'll make it. It's a shame. It's a shame because, you know, people talk about the New York prejudice with the Hall of Fame. And Rizzuto got in and Reese got in.
Yeah.
And Wills didn't get in. I'm not saying that Wills was the greatest shortstop to ever put on a uniform, but his stats are right there.
He was electrifying.
He was, and his cold statistics are right there with all the right. whole bunch of other Hall of Fame shortstops.
And was anyway, so electrifying.
Yeah. Yeah, he was. He was electrifying. He got the whole stadium up on its feet. I mean, even Absolutely. On the road, even Absolutely. On the road, when the Dodgers would come into Shea Stadium, excuse me, or before that, the Polo Grounds, as visitors, the whole place was up and go, you know, go, Maury, go. I mean, it was just unbelievable. When he stole second base, and then he would steal third base, and the crowd would be going ape, you know? Mm-hmm. And
Did he ever steal home?
You know what? That's a good question. I don't think so. I don't think that was in vogue.
Yeah.
At the time. Robert, mm-hmm. do you know anything about that?
No, I do not. I don't recall ever seeing that he stole home.
No, I don't know. I don't know.
Jackie stole home 19 times.
Yes. But there are people, there are ball players that stole home more, way more than 19 times. You can look that up.
Are there really?
Oh, yeah. Way more. Now, I'm not talking 21 or 22. I'm talking like a 50, 70, whatever.
Really?
Anyway, Maury Wills, still alive, still lives a quiet life, goes to, shows up at Dodger old-timers games. I don't think he suits up anymore, but he certainly waves and stands up and smiles and goes to the dinners and all that stuff.
Right.
So Maury's still with us, and I want to thank both of you for your contributions today. We only have a couple of minutes. The producer says we're out of time. This has been comfortably – no, it has not been a comfortably – I'm living in the past. I only had one beer with dinner, too. One beer. This has been Dodger Baseball Chronicles, the Maury Wills Show. My name is Peter Trunk. My partners are Ron Rabinowitz and Robert Cole. I want to thank them, and I want to thank all our viewers. I want to thank our viewers who continue – their generous ways, many of them, more than a few, I'll say, sending me free Dodger memorabilia, Dodger stuff to this day. Just absolutely incredible people that watch these shows. And I want to thank them from the bottom of my heart. Thanks, gentlemen. And we're going to do this again soon. We'll do another Dodger star. And I want to say, I want to bid you both a fond good night, and our audience also. Thank you very much.